welcome into the form where Te Rapa takes centre stage this weekend, highlighted by the two Group 1s, the BCD Group Sprint and the Group 1 Herbie Dyke Stakes. So to take you through the action and try and find the winners is Aidan Rodley and Bevan Sweeney. And we've got so much to unpack, so let's have a look what's coming up on the agenda. We'll start with the two feature Group 1s out of Te Rapa. Our racetrack is, as usual, heading to Riccarton for the Banks Peninsula Cup preview. The Te Rapa features on the undercard, including the Group 2 David and Karen Ellis Fillies Classic, Harness with the Whale 2 meetings to touch on there, and our best bets, as usual, to round out the show. Yes, we've just come off a massive couple of weeks of racing, and it continues this weekend with Te Rapa, two Group 1s to look forward to. So Aidan Rodley, good morning to you. What's the weather looking like in your region?
Pretty good, actually, Philippa. Good morning to you, and really looking forward to one of the big days of racing in the Waikato. And we head to Te Rapa for a couple of Group 1s, also that Group 2 and a rich race on the undercard as well. It says there's a few showers, but whether they eventuate, not too sure. Clearing to find this evening. You've got a high of 26 degrees, rail in the true position. This track will be nigh on perfect, and conditions likely to be much the same.
That's what we want to hear. Well, let's touch on the first of the Group 1s, race number 8 on the program. It is the BCD Group Sprint over the 1,400 metres at Wait for Age. And the unbeaten Crochetti heads the market at $2.30. You've got White Act there at $4.50 and Quintessa at $7, the only other runner in single figures. So you're getting double odds for every other runner, including multiple stakes-placed runners. There's in preview too across the page at 51s. What about the speed, Aidan? There looks to be plenty of it, so who do you see leading?
Yeah, I expect probably that it'll be If in Doubt, Get Out, who will push forward from a gate out wide. Crochetti will want to take advantage of a good barrier draw and be somewhere handy. Callsign Map will get forward as well. And then you might see a horse like I'm Wonderful Tonight there. Those get back horses, Dragon Leap, you'd expect Whiteack to get back as well. Habana probably midfield from a decent barrier draw.
Well, that's the speed. Let's have a look now at some key form leading in. We'll take you back firstly to the Group 1 Railway, featuring a couple of runners here, including Whiteack Aidan, who was pretty impressive from last to first.
Absolutely. Just an amazing performance from Whiteack. When you look at where this horse was and the quality of horses in front of him, Bodyless about to get a decent bump here from Mercurial. Her run was full of merit as always. Dragon Leap out wider went past her. Dragon Leap comes past, but all the action towards the inside, and Whiteack ultra impressive. Warren Kennedy opts for Crochetti though, Bevan. How important is that?
I think it's just an obvious decision really, with his association with the horse and the team that, around that particular horse. That was a massive performance. The seeded open, it really did open up with that little bit of interference with Bonnie Lassen that involved. Horse is clearly going well. I know you saw the horse on Tuesday, and clearly the horse is going very, very well, but he's going to have to come from last or second last again with Dragon Leap. You've got Crochetti, who probably trails. Either Callsign Merv on Wonderful Tonight, If in Doubt, Get Out, probably the one with all the speed. Look, I'm going to be pretty boring on the form this week. I've been trying to get a couple of these short-price favourites beaten, Aidan. I don't think I'm going to, but yeah, Whiteack is in flying form. Here is a wonderful horse, and this was a great return, Aidan. He had the position and the run, and everything went right for him on the night, but he's just got attitude, just put him away. He's got that very clean action, and look, his winning run can just continue.
Yeah, absolutely. This was his seventh from as many starts. It was against three-year-old company. This is a massive step up in grade to Group 1 Wait for Age company, but he carried 60 kilograms in this win, drops to 55.5, and yeah, he's just a pretty special horse. Big race to be putting his unbeaten record on the line, and we will get a real test on it. This is Quintessa, just on the outside, three-year-old filly here who steps up to Wait for Age. This isn't easy either. They did it with Maven Bell last year. Speaking to Mark Walker earlier in this week, he thinks that Quintessa may be a touch better. So who win last time out in the Living Classic first class, and she's never been worse than second so far in her career. Just adds to a really quality lineup in the BCD Group Sprint, Philippa.
Really does, and that's just the three or four that we've touched on. What about their trainers? Let's hear from them, and we'll start with Andrew Scott. Aidan just asked him how his two runners are.
Yeah, they're both doing really well. Like I say, look, Dragon Leap, not a lot when he's way down at Wellington. Sort of got caught out in the limb, and there's a loose horse, and sort of impeded his gallop a wee bit, and It didn't quite go the speed that we'd hoped, but look, he's had a good couple of weeks since. He's handling the racing in the summer, racing really well, and he's got a good bit of soundness about him. His work here on Tuesday is up to his normal high levels. He gets around Tarapa really well. We think sort of 1400 metres is his peak distance, so we're really confident he's going to run well.
Okay, and just tell us about Whitehack. What have you done with him since Soroa?
Look, we went across to Tarapa last Wednesday, and he had a nice hit out there between races, and he was a little above himself that day, and he's done a wee bit of work since Saturday. He had a nice hit out, and again on Tuesday, and we're really pleased with him. He's going well, he's another one. He really gets around Tarapa well. 1400 metres is is probably his peak distance too as well, he's actually just walking past right there. But he's in really good form. So, there's even a shower of rain possibly looking around on Saturday, and that would just probably bring him into it a wee bit more. So, he's in good form, and obviously with OP on board, it certainly gives you a wee bit more confidence. So, he's in good spirits, and he's fighting fit and sound. So he'll make a strong account of himself for sure.
She's tough as nails, and she tries her hardest, and she was a bit stiff after the race, and I sent her out to JK Farms for a week, and she's come back really well. She's as tough as they come, and she's stretching out well, she's looking really well, and she's happy, and her work has been really good. So strong field, so it'll be very interesting to see over 1400 metres. Like, even her last run in the Telegraph suggested she 1400's her go.
Yeah, she's going great. She came through her run the other day really well again, so we've just pressed on, and she's in a good place.
Yeah, he's good. His trial was very nice. It's a very good field, but he'll run a hell of a race.
Yeah, we haven't seen him since the 2000 Guineas. Of course, that was a Group 1 as well. What has he sort of done in the interim?
No, he got gelded after that and had a good spell. And as you see, he trialled at Taupo, went a nice trial. So he's very fit for Saturday, and we'll just assess everything after Saturday, and he'll probably stick to like a mile race after that, I would say, for sure.
I thought the ride was the winning of the race, and obviously she got all favours and certainly didn't that day. So, no, she's a very good filly and knows how to win. She should run very well, but it's a top-class field.
It's one heck of a field, all right. So, Aidan, selection time. Who's the one for you?
Yeah, in the end, I've gone with Crocetti. Last three-year-old to win this race was Extravagant, going back to 2016. But he's unbeaten in seven. He was really impressive at Ellerslie last time out. This undoubtedly is a step up, and that's just a query how he copes. But he's looked very good so far. Bevan, you're with him as well?
I had to be with him. Racing needs heroes, and this fellow will get a cult following if he can win on Saturday. And when you think we've got Imperatrix about to step out, this also, I imagine, will step out across the Tasman. We saw Jimmy Starr being brilliant last Saturday, and then our three-year-olds are about to head over the ditch in the autumn. Australia might be in a little bit of stress if Crocetti can take this out, and he is clearly my top selection pick.
The guys are both agreeing on Crocetti. Now let's move on to another Group 1 on the card, and it is the Herbie Dyke Stakes over 2,000 metres, headed by Legato, 175, Campanessa at 650. Then you got last year's winner, Sharp and Smart, at $8, and Aquacade at $9. What about speed? Over the 2,000 metres, Aidan, is there much in it?
Well, that's the real query here, Pip, because there's no clear leader in this race. We've got Mazzolino heading right forward, and not really her modus operandi either. So the means Legato gets probably to a trail, and we don't normally see her that close, but there's just a real lack of it here. Just might mean those sort of back runners, the One Wild Cats, Arby, Lady Talina, just might have things against them here. But it'll be really interesting just to see how positive riders are in this race.
Really will be. Well, let's have a look now at the favourite. She's 175 in the market. We'll take you back to Karaka Million Night. What did you make of her second here, Aidan, now that she steps up to the 2,000?
Phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. This is a run and a half. They've run one in 32 and a half, and she's taken three lengths off the winner, Desert Lightning, in the last 600 metres. A phenomenal performance. Desert Lightning's a horse who is in the mix. He's not up with Imperatrix yet, but in the horse of the year calculations, she is a quality horse. This was a quality performance. Boy, she impressed me this day, Bevan.
Oh, she's all class, and the winner is all class as well. And maybe with that track condition that we've read about in the stops report, maybe just as they cornered and lost a bit of momentum and then really had to build again, whereas Desert Lightning was on the rail and off and gone. He is a sharp, sharp horse. Everything works for me. You've said it all about probably the best horse in the country in my mind, in Legato. She gets the draw, she'll land handier than normal, she'll hit a flat spot, but I think she is the winner, no doubt about that.
Okay, we'll move you on to the next of them, Campionessa, and of course a winner of the Zabel Classic under the similar conditions, weight for age 2000, this time going the other way around, of course, so right-hander, but all the horses here, no compromise. Maybe just failed back to a wet track and at Trentham in the Thorndon Mile. He's going to be better, obviously, a Group 1 winner over 2,400 metres in Australia and some other pretty handy performances, but she just came through really well this day, Campionessa. She'd won the Auckland Thoroughbred Breeders and the Kalai Zuzu in her two previous runs. And she's just got some grit out of about her, doesn't she, Bevan? She just really wanted to win this.
And why not go and sit and jump and run up on speed with Campionessa with the lack of speed in here? Because you know the attitude this mare has. She is tough as teak. She's got a good turn of foot. If she sits up there and looks Legato in the eye halfway down the home straight, Legato will know she's in for a fight. The one run out of that and the over I see, albeit we don't have a lot of tempo in this race, is they were shopping $3 and change around one bold cat. I thought that horse was exceptional that day. It's been to Trentham and just had that prep run coming into what should be its perfect trip, one bold cat. But if they go forward with Campionessa, and there's absolutely no reason not to with the tempo in this particular race, she'll be right there inside the 200 metre mark, and things might just change up late in that particular race.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think they can be positive if they want to with Campionessa here, and it will be interesting just to see how this race does pan out, because on exposed form, not a lot of speed. Womble Cap very good at Trentham last time out as well.
Time to head back out to the trainers. This time we'll start with Debbie Rogerson, and Aidan just asked her how last year's winner Sharp and Smart is.
Yeah, he's great. Things didn't quite work out from last start, but he went super, had a good hit out, pulled up tremendous. His work was really good yesterday, so I'm looking forward to Saturday.
Really liked his last run. He wasn't at home on the wettest track, but come on brilliantly. I think the 2000 looks like a very good forecast ahead of us, and it should really suit.
Okay, also in there is Mazzolino. Her form's been A-OK too. What are you making of her?
She looks outstanding. She's in foal. I think sort of last start, I just think they in the Trentham Stakes, they just ran so hard, it just sort of didn't really suit her, sort of had her out of her comfort zone the whole way. Usually these sort of races, weight for age, they don't run as quick, anywhere near as quick. So, you know, she should get a much better run. Her start before that at Group 1 level, weight for age was great running fourth. So, no, it's going to be a great field, but she'll get her chance.
Yeah, both boys are going very well. Obviously, Marley Stone went to Tirapa last week for an exhibition gallop, and Sam Roderman, honestly, never seen him work so good. He's just really thriving, and just, it's really good to see.
And he's done okay this week as well?
Yeah, he has. Like I said, he just worked yesterday with Tulsi over 1,000 metres, and, yeah, his work was very encouraging too.
Okay, and Arby, how's he tracking?
Yeah, he's really good. Look, his last start run at Ellerslie was very, very good. I thought, obviously, a leader bias track on Karakamillion night, and he was last the whole way and really stormed home and run fifth, so huge run. Steps up to the 2,000, which look, he's really wanting now, and look, I think he's probably the big danger in the race.
I certainly wasn't disappointed with the run. I think, you know, that the night was a bias front running track. I thought, you know, Jelly Sauce is always going to be the horse to beat. He's a very good horse, as he showed in the Thorndon Mile, and you know, he was hard to peg back, and we got back a bit, and Wessex didn't help by going out to the long lead, so no, I certainly wasn't disappointed. I think on the night she was beaten by a better horse that was suited to the track, and she made up an enormous amount of ground to come from. She wouldn't get in within a length and a quarter. Her sectionals are very good, so certainly not disappointed with the run.
We think so. Her form before that was first class, so, and she unfortunately drew down the inside that day, so that was the kiss of death, really, down on the inside. So she's bounced through it well. We can't fault her. So now she'll be make her presence felt Saturday.
Absolutely, she will. But again, it's time for selections. Aidan, can you go past Legato?
I can't. I thought she was a special in this race. She's going to lean handy enough to be a real factor in there. And Well, Sharp and Smart's looking for back-to-back wins. So too is Ryan Elliott, who combined with Sharp and Smart last year. He's on Legato, and I think he'll be winning this race again. Bevan, you?
Agreed. I think she's the best horse in the country. In my opinion, I thought her run at Ellerslie was absolutely massive. She's got the right draw in a race with not a lot of speed. So I think she clears the one. There is a boosted double out, Crescetti Legato, 475. That seemed an over to me, but with Legato in this year's Herbie Duck.
Yeah, I like that. I'll be scooting off to take that after this. And don't forget too, of course, it's Legends Day, so we've got the Grand Tour bonus back. You can get a bonus bet up to $50 if you run second, third or fourth, and that's across the first six races instead of the first four. So well worth having an investment there. And also from Riccarton, Caulfield and Randwick, we'll have the standard racing bonus back there across the first four races. So make sure you tune in nice and early on Saturday if you want to catch all the oil with Connections. Tune in to the Punters Lounge live nice and early, 11 a.m. with Bevan Sweeney. Racetracker time. Aidan, let's start with you. Who have you found this week?
Take you to Matamata on Wednesday, and one who did start really well backed in the market, Rising Tide, got a long way back from a very wide draw. So you're looking for the horse in the Oak Stud colours, back last at this point in the white pom-pom. Does get home really nicely. You can see there's a fair bit going on in this race. A lot of closes because they did run it solidly enough. And this horse just got squeezed up, right, just ducking back towards the inside and looking for a run. And on that, it looked maybe there, but we'll show you the head on, because there's the horse out wide looking for a run, no run, dive back to the inside. And then looks as though there's a gap that's going to open up between the inside two and the outside two. But that just closes in the end. A really nice run from Rising Tide, who I really want to be on next time out.
I thought there was an outstanding performance Tuesday in the Wairarapa Breeders, and it was a relief to see Manifeet back to somewhere near her best. She was a mystery at Trentham. Just cop her last sectional here. There's three good mares in front of her. She's hit the line really, really strongly. Her sectional will be outstanding in this particular race. She'll go to Matamata to the Kaimai Stakes, I believe. And if she was to win there, she'll probably go on to the Buncrasher. And I think she is well capable, Manifeet, to take out one of those very big races.
And I'm going to head to Palmerston North on Tuesday, take you to an unbeaten greyhound. He's 4 from 4, Hazel Go. I think he's one of the best youngsters going around, and he's going to climb the grades. He puts pay to a very good field here in a 25.46. That's open class time. Now, there's a Group 1 St. Ledger in a couple of weeks' time, restricted age. He's restricted age greyhound. Wouldn't be surprised to see him going down there. There'll be a futures market, and I would certainly be taking him in that. I know there's a lot of talk around him being one of the best dogs to grace Lisa Cole's kennel for some time, and he is certainly showing that he's all go, a greyhound to follow, I think, going right through the spring and autumn months. And you can just see there, he's just quick off the lids too, does everything right. Let's have a look at a summary. We're going to pop these in your race trackers on tab.co.nz. Rising Tide for Aidan, Bevan's with Manifeet, and I'm going for He's All Go. It's Banks Peninsula Cup Day at Riccarton on Saturday. So Aidan, I know it was chilly further down south last weekend. What's the weather looking like this time?
Yeah, not too bad. Obviously, there's been a bit of a wet period, and so hence why we've got slow conditions, soft conditions as we lead into Saturday. Hopefully, that's going to see these clouds disperse, and we'll see decent conditions. But at the moment, 26 degrees and looking like a good day in Christchurch.
Let's have a look at the feature at Riccarton in the Banks Peninsula Cup to see who heads the betting. I know it is a pretty open at the moment in the market. And Eminon is in here at $4.50. You've got Spartan at $5. Our Echo at $6.50. And Fafita at $6.50. So very, very open for the SC Stevens Memorial Banks Peninsula Cup. Let's head back to a key lead into this race with Eminon here, who runs third, Aidan, but really had to work for the lead, so hung on there pretty well.
Yeah, absolutely. It is a really good performance from one who continues to race really well. Could we see the sister double from Legato and the big sister Eminon, who did fight well, let's add, coming down the outside for the win. But at this point you're thinking, well, she might run fourth or fifth, but she just kicks back as she does. She's a real fighter. Track conditions, no real concern. It's either way. Abdul Najib takes the 3 kilograms off to 56.5. And I think we'll see Eminem back in the winner's circle this weekend.
What about this charge for Fida? Let's take you back to him winning at Wingatui over the 1,200 metres. How does this form stack up for you, Aidan?
Yeah, pretty well. This is the previous day. This is Waikawaiti Cup Day, which was on far better conditions than what we saw there last Saturday. So you can see there, just stalking O'Jessica, goes up and then really wants to win. So it's a decent ride from Tina Kominyagi as we get used to watching South Island racing. But a good fighting effort from Fafita, who's now won 4 of 14. This is a little bit of a step up, but a horse going in the right direction and definitely a contender. However, for me, I'm going with our first video. That's with number 2, Eminon. I think she'll be back in the winner's circle. Wouldn't it be great, especially for Warwick Jeffries, of course, bred them both. Legado, who goes around the Herbie Dyke, and Eminon, who goes around in the Banks Peninsula Cup.
Absolutely, you can do a little sister multi there if you like. And again, don't forget the first 4 races out of Riccarton are bonus back opportunities, as well as across the Tasman. We have Caulfield and Randwick in play as well. And you can catch the first race from 12:10. Time to head back off to Te Rapa and have a look at the other features on the program. We'll start with the Group 2. David and Karen Ellis, Phillies Classic here. Molly Bloom at 3:30 heads the betting. And you've got Sabina at $5. Mary Shan at $6. Grail Seeker at $8.50. And Inspired by Art at $8.50. So what a field. Even mentioning some there across the page, you're outside of Spring Queen at $61. Let's take you back now to the Group 2 8 Carat Classic. Plenty of runners to look out of here, Aidan, including the winner, Molly Bloom.
Yep, Molly Bloom was excellent this day. Obviously, this was a hot, hot field, and the form stacked up really well. So the first 6 home go around here. Also see Mary Shan, who is in front, fights really hard. Closer to the inside, that's Grail Seeker, About Time, who's come out and won the Sir Patrick Hogan Stakes since then. Really good runs in there as well from the likes of Livid Sky. So yeah, even Tulsi, who was caught wide and then has gone on to run really well in second at Ellerslie. Good form race, Bevan. Did you find the winner of the David Ellis, the David and Karen Ellis Phillies Classic out of that race?
Oh, I'm still a massive fan of Molly Bloom. I thought her run at Ellerslie was good enough to say that she'll improve into this particular race. I think she's got a great gait to find the right spot, and who knows where Orchestral Ceiling is. So I was very, very keen on her as a very, very strong winning chance. About Time is an interesting runner. We saw it there. We then take you forward to this run at Counties on a New Year's Day, where it was too good for Still Being On, who had been very good in a wet track at Trentham. But this is a progressive horse. The draw's going to be a little bit of a niggle. It's had a couple of really nice runs, Aidan, where it's got a split down the inside. It was good enough to take advantage of that on this day. But there might be 2 or 3 horses in this race that maybe are a level above this race.
Yeah, interesting, and a wide barrier draw for this race won't help. Obviously, Warren Kennedy was on fire this day, and everything he was riding seemed to be winning. Both Livid Sky and Still Bang On, especially, was very good running in behind them. So, yeah, their form looks solid, and of course, those horses have run 2,000 metres, whereas a few of these are stepping up to that middle distance for the first time. Go and have a look at the Desert Gold Stakes at Trentham last time out. So this is Hidbina, who's now looking for a hat-trick after good wins at Hastings and this one at Trentham last time out. And it seemed to be a good performance. Just, I'm not so sure how we stack this form up. Rain-affected track, 1,600 metres, but she was really good in doing it, Bevan.
I think this form will stack up, Rod, just the way she put them away in a couple of quick bounds, and she sprinted hard, and look, they were a long way away from the remainder of that particular field. So I think the form really, really stacks up around this horse. I think it is a major player, and the biggest niggle may just be gate number 1 at Te Rapa, with a horse who's going to get back maybe 5-6 back the fence and have to loop the field. And we know it is very tough at times to really make up a heck of a lot of ground at Te Rapa. So apart from that negative, I think the horse is going really, really well. Mary Shan might get some cover from positivity. I think Mary Shan is a player again going well. Molly Bloom. So hey, it's another great 3-year-old event, Pip.
Oh, it really is. So let's hear how the trainers think their charges are tracking. We'll start once again with Andrew Scott, and Aidan just asked him how his fillies are.
Yeah, both fillies are flying. Look, they had a nice piece here on Tuesday morning. Their work's been, you know, they both come with, you know, good high standards of work, both fit, both first attempt over ground, but they're sort of on the bounce. One's coming in 3 weeks between runs, the other with a fortnight. Like you say, Molly Broome, not everything went away that night. She got a pretty wide, nothing was winning out that wide that night, but the sectionals were good, and if anything, we think she's improved a bit with the run, and she'll bounce back. She's very consistent. It was probably a little bit below her best, but we think she's, rod on a game, and she'll run well. Grail Seeker's super consistent filly. Another one, not quite everything went her way down at Wellington, sort of blundering about the half mile and then having to pick herself up and then the winner having the last crack at her. But look, she's going really well. She's a terrific track worker and she's a big, scopey filly that should really eat up the 2,000 metres. So two really good chances.
I think it'll suit Positivity. She's a big, rangy type who just struggled on a shifty track at Trentham last start. She never really got going in the ground. So she'll be better suited on a firmer deck on Saturday. And Mary Shan, I'm not sure. She's got brilliance, that's obvious, but she's now got to prove she can take that to 2,000 metres.
Okay, the ability all there with Positivity, and like you say, things just didn't quite go right last time out. How has she done since?
She's done really well. She's a lightly tried horse who's still a bit raw and learning as she goes, but I think she could be hitting her straps at the right time.
Yeah, I thought it was a very good run. I mean, obviously the rail was out that day and they were sort of winning on speed, and leader obviously got away with very cheap sectionals, but her run coming from the back, yeah, it was very, very encouraging.
Her last two wins have been impressive, but they have been on rain-affected tracks. Going to be quite a different track on Saturday. Picking it'll be a very fast track. Having said that, she did win a maiden quite well on a good track at Taupo. 2,000 metres for the first time. The way she's been running out a mile suggests that she'll get the trip. I'm confident she will. But it's a very good field, as it normally is, but I think we're right in the mix.
Very good. I was lucky enough to go on the rail yesterday and they both worked very good. I scratched Livid Sky from Taranaki, thinking the track was a bit heavy, so they both run together. This Saturday, Livid Sky, possibly a touch fitter than the other filly, hasn't run for a month or so, but will still run very good.
Well, yeah, she's at the rating, she's really got a step up, but we think she's a really nice staying type of filly, and once she gets out to the Oaks distance, we think she'll be spot on.
Yeah, two starts ago she won very good at Te Rapa. I thought she won lovely. The other day, didn't really like the track at all, but was good to the line. Come through it well, quick back up. Look, she's a very rough chance in a very good field.
Some great info there from their trainers. I don't envy you guys trying to pick one. So who's the bet for you, Aidan?
I've gone for Molly Bloom. The run at Ellerslie last time out, we're just getting too far back in a race that really was dominated by those closer to the speed, was very good. And her prior two wins, the 1,000 guineas and the 8-carat, were both the first class. I thought Mary Shan was a real danger to her, but I've gone with Molly Bloom on top. Bevan, how about you?
Yep, I'm with you. I think she's a bit of a star, and maybe you didn't see the real horse just with that Ellerslie tempo and way that track was playing. I think she'll bounce back on Saturday, but there's plenty of challenges. I think it is a very, very strong group of 3-year-old fillies. Sabina, I thought, Roger's got concerns about the track conditions. I really don't have that many concerns. I think she can really ping that horse, and I think she's coming into the mix as one of the better 3-year-old fillies as well. And I agree, Mary Shan, I think Positivity might come across, give Mary a little bit of relief when she did all the chasing at her most recent performance. But Molly Bloom for me.
A lot of agreement today on the form as we move on to race number 7, the Sir Patrick Hogan Karapiro Stakes. And this is Adam I Am at $2, the Odyssey at $9, Reputation at $9, and To Catch a Thief at $12 is how the market is playing. So a clear-cut favourite. And then across the page, you're getting out to runners like Cinnamon there at $26. Let's take you back to the favourite, Adam I Am at Te Araha, back on January the 3rd, and he was good once again here, Aidan.
Yeah, it really was. Stepped up to 1,600 metres and did it nicely. He's only lightly tried. He's only had 5 starts so far, but he's shown real class in 3 wins to date. Connections opted to just stay away from Ellerslie in the Aotearoa Classic, the 4-year-old race, to have a crack at this $350,000, and why not? He looks pretty progressive, Bevan.
He's more than progressive. He'll be going right through the top level, and he probably maps to sit outside Vera Rose, and then there might be a couple that have come across him. So he's in the right posse. He's hardly been asked here. Look, it is a step up again, but you get Malcolm McNabb on board, the senior rider going aboard. And he's one that I find very difficult to beat, actually. Mars might be an opponent if we go back a couple of starts in this performance. Behind Orchestral, the form has really stacked up there, hasn't it, Aidan? And this horse is going okay, but there was a bit of an issue there at Trentham. So you're taking a little bit on trust, and the draw probably puts him on the hind quarter of Adam IM, and that might be a positive position.
Yeah, there's a fighting performance. Orchestral, obviously, we've seen her class since as well. But pretty handy this day. And obviously, they just had that breathing issue last time out. So you know that Ben Foot would have got it remedied. Barrier 2 gets a soft run from there. So, yeah, an upset chance. And from the same stable, Ben and Ryan Foot will produce the Odyssey. He's won 4 of the last 5. This is a super win. Courtney Barnes down there for the one ride. She sticks with the ship here. And a horse who's 2 from 2 at Tarapa, so no concerns here. Just seems to be going the right way. And a definite contender here, going for 2 of these new races. Wins on the bounce, Bevan.
Yeah, it'll be a good performance because a couple of times up over the 2100 metres, coming back to the 1600 where he hasn't won at this stage, but beat a really good horse there, make no mistake, and is a talent there. There's no doubt about that from a reasonable sort of gait. We'll get back over the 1600 metres, you'd imagine, at this point in its career, but hey, it'll be a good training and placing performance from the Foot team if they'll pick up 2 of those new bonus races. One other to look at, that is Vera Rose. And if you want the speed map special in this particular race with a progressive type of horse, it probably is Vera Rose. You can see her jumping and going forward. Adam Ian will sit to the outside, you'd imagine. And then there'll be questions asked from other riders whether they really want to come forward and take the speed on with Vera Rose and Adam Ian sitting there. And Piers Anders Graberg to do the riding here, Aidan.
Yep, comes in from Sweden. I saw him riding track work on Tuesday, doing a bit of work for Tony Pike. And of course, teams up with the Pike stable here on a filly who definitely has the ability as well. But you go to the class factor and the market leader on top. I've gone with Adam IM pretty clearly in this too. Bevan, how about you?
As I said at the start of the show, I'm not full of any surprises today. I just think the favourites on a champion's day might just champion the punters home. And I think Adam IM is still a very, very progressive horse. He's been very carefully handled. He's got another great speed map to be taking this out. And he is clearly and clearly probably one of the bets for me on the programme.
Like it, and this could help with what we've got to look forward to on Saturday as well with our quaddies. And we do have a $75,000 quaddie on races 6 to 9, includes of course the Sir Patrick Hogan Karapiro Classic there, and races 7 to 10 at Riccarton Park, a $30,000 guaranteed quaddie. We look forward to Emily Bosson, Brendan and Aidan on track on Saturday on Trackside 1. And don't forget too, we've got the Premier Channel back with Waikato Stud. That's from 3:10 to 7:10, channel 64, for your extended coverage with Bevan and I. So looking forward to all of that coming up on Saturday. It's that time on the form, our harness segment with Craig. And Craig, as I say, good morning to you. What a night on Friday we've got to look forward to out of Addington with New Zealand Breeders' Stakes.
Yeah, good morning, Philippa. Good morning, form viewers. It is a cracking night, isn't it? Group 1 Faye Fensire Breeders' Stakes, of course, last year taken out by Kelly's Delight. We've got a really even field here, Philippa. We've got a $2.50 favourite here, but it has been well-founded, All-American Lover. Open at $3. Lady of the Light, the Northerner. Now, she's at $3 as well. Manhattan at $7. Kahlua Flyby, who was good last start at $10 second row draw. Interesting with Mr. Kaplan, Barrier number 2. Now with the All-Stars in the North Island, used to be a gate fly, but not really a 2,600-metre horse. And we get down to Treacherous Gal, $31. Ran the best splits out of the Mayor's race last week. Joe's Rock ran placing in this race last year, $61, and Dance Till Dawn pick up drive for Blair Orange with John Dunn being in the north. Probably the key guide to the race and speed map wise is Lady of the Light. Now, she's got good gate speed. She's got a great draw, similar draw to what she had last year when she led this race. She drew 2, she draws 3 here on Friday night. Mr. Kaplan Life's the Beach also gets out of the gate. Where's this put All-American Lover? Well, she's drawn Barrier 4. It's not a bad draw for her. She's not quick off, but she'll probably posse one off, very handy at the speed. Manhattan out wider, and I predict the rest of them from 6, 7, 8, 9 will come back from the draw. Key video to show you. 2 weeks ago, Group 2 Premier Mares race, All-American Lover outstanding, outside Manhattan from the last 800 metres. Lady of the Light in the 1-1, on the inside of it, Fernley Blackbird, and then you've got the runs out wide here. So coming wide on the track is Kahlua Flyby. At this point, Manhattan's going okay, but Tim Williams had a decent look across and said, I've got you covered. Strode to the front, kicks the plugs and gets away. I thought it was a really good performance. The problem I've got with her this week is I'm not sure she can find the front. I'm not sure she can sit parked out and win this race. It's a very tactical race. The time was quite good, 56 last quarter and 28, but it wasn't the fastest run race on the night. All You Need Is Me actually went about 0.3 of a second faster. So if you're taking the 250 about All-American Lover, you're hoping she doesn't have to sit outside Lady of the Light. She couldn't do it in this race last year. I think the better video to show is the Group 1 from 4 weeks ago. Top of the lane, Queen of Hearts, Lady of the Light and Maurice McKendry rolling. Remember, she drew barrier 8 on this night, crossed them in a heartbeat to get across Manhattan, who's in the trail. You've got All-American Lover there running on with its stablemate. Lady of the Light burnt at the candle at the start and at the finish, 240 overall. And I reckon that with the advantage of having obviously 2 weeks between its first up run, I think it's the big improver. Not much between them, Philippa, but if I had to go for one, I think Lady of the Light's the way to play here. She's starting to get out in the market with the money coming from All-American Lover. If she posies up in front of her, I think she holds tactical advantage. Great to see Maurice McKendry back on board, a mare that got him a Group 1 3 weeks ago.
Absolutely, Craig. And another race, of course, we want to touch on is the Continental Event Hire Summer Free-for-All Mobile Trot, and it features Oscar Bonavina.
Well, he's a class act. We saw him last week. Gee, he just dominated. He rolled forward for Nelly. He stepped brilliantly. Those who took the $1.20, it was an easy watch. Well, I tell you what, he's not a $1.20 this week. He's a $1.10, but rightly so, because he meets the same field. Smoke and Bandar, the Grey Flash, he's $6. Nazareth, the Derby win, $21. Interesting runner, Styx Jewel. Gee, she's looked good coming through the grades. High Speed Mare, $21 as well. And then you're getting out to the likes of Tutangata, who was placed last week at $31. Let's have a look at the key video, because gee, he dominated in front and he has been backed for the trot slot race. Now, he is your third favourite for the big race on the Night of Champions. That's him in front, Natalie. Gee, what a great resumption for her driving after 6 months sitting on the sideline when he's sitting behind Oscar and he's off and gone in a 56 last half. The Grey Flash I thought was great. He actually ran the best sectionals out of the race. So he's run his last mile 156, home in 56.5, and he's run his last quarter 28. He's gone the best sectionals, but still couldn't live with the leader. He made up a lot of ground, and I expect it to be the same Quinella. You're not going to take $1.10 about Oscar, but I tell you what, you may take $1.60 around Smoke and Bandar to run second again. Oscar stands out. Well, it's going to be a great race on Friday night, Philippa.
Like it, Craig. And of course, Addington, not the only track in play on Friday. So if a harness fan, we've also got Alexandra Park to look forward to. Firstly, we'll touch on the three-year-old race, Craig, featuring Chase a Dream.
Yeah, great field, Philippa. Of course, it's a harness racing million prelude to next week. And all the big guns are here, and they're headed up by, I think, the best horse in the field in Chase a Dream. But a little bit cautious on him this week, Philippa. He missed a race last week. He's had two trials. We'll touch on them shortly. Let's have a look at the market. He's $1.85. He's moved from $2. Better Knuckle Up at $6. Cold Chisel, $6.50. Hadrian Collider, Barrier 1, $8. And the speed influence in the race may be Le Major at $9, because he can go forward and he's got a medium barrier draw. Going to have a look at Chase a Dream at the trials the other day. He was excellent. He's had two trials this time in. That's his stablemate, Vesem, on the outside. He's in front, and he just rolled along. Now, the problem I've got with Chase a Dream this week is that, as I said, it is a prelude to a big final next week. He's drawn out wide at barrier number 6. We've never seen him really lit up off the gate. And because of his race day fitness, there's always that concern that, you know, he's probably at 80% screwed down for next week. If he goes back from the draw over 1,700 metres and you're taking $1.85 and a Le Major's rolling in front, or the Surfer, and he has to come wide on the track, it's a hard way to earn your $1.85. Is he the best horse in the race? Absolutely. His quality is untapped. He's a sire stakes winner and he deserves to be favourite. But just be a little bit cautious this week. Cold Chisel, he's a little bit like Chase a Dream. Haven't seen him since November. but he's been good at the trial. So have a look at this. This is a key video to show because these are the two Harness Million runners for next week. We've got Coastal Babe and the Phillies Brigade in front. On the outside is Cole Chisel. Just in behind them, LeMajor. So it was a really quiet trial, LeMajor. Now you see Cole Chisel just roll over the top of Coastal Babe late in the piece. It was a lovely workout. The run home in good sectionals. Zach Butcher takes the drive. He's $6.50. So if you don't want to take the $1.80 around the favourite, I do think he's backable. I thought it's a tricky race to play into. I think Chaser Dream's the best horse in the race, but I'm just going to bypass him this week, and I'm going to play something on an each-way basis, and it's Better Knuckle Up, a horse that's been very good when its last three starts, has race day fitness on a size. More importantly, you're getting $6.50. Maybe kind of a two-over-three play, Philippa, on a $6 shot.
Yeah, we like a little bit of value on the show, Craig. What about race number 9? Let's move on to the Mobile Pace. Might be small in numbers, but certainly isn't in quality.
Well, it's not. I mean, here we go. We've got Merlin up against Self Assured as we look at the market here. Four runners, good for the club to get it off the ground. $1.40 for Merlin. I reckon that's a fair price for a horse that's obviously a Derby winner who's got a slot in the Grins announced this week. Isn't that great for SENZ with this horse, Merlin, being the first horse into the race the night of champions in April. Self-Assured, the $2 million earner at $3.20, and then you get out to Max Shard at $20. Here's Merlin last week at Alexandra Park, or a fortnight ago in front here. This was no more than a workout. When I say that, they only run home at 57 seconds. They go quicker at the workouts. He beats Sooner the Better, who's in Sydney at the moment, trying to get a spot in the Chariots of Fire. He doesn't win by much, but that's just Merlin. He kind of does what he has to do. Zach Butcher driving again. He's drawn inside, Self-Assured, and that's the key to the race. I think the gate speed will actually come from his stablemate, Max Shard. I think he'll roll to the front, and then maybe he'll let his stablemate go in Merlin. So it's 2,200 metres. Hey, we've only got four runners, but boy, we've got two very good horses in Merlin and Self-Assured. Just on Self-Assured, well, it's great to have him back. I mean, he races so well at Alexandra Park. His record here is exemplary. This is the best version of him. Winning the Group 1 free-for-all at Addington with Tony Hurley running down the outside and getting over the top of Akuta on a day where we thought Akuta was unbeatable. Self-Assured, when he's good, he's very good. Obviously, a winner of the race by Grins. We saw him after this go to Invercargill where he lined up and ran second behind American Me in a Group 1. I don't think he'll be Merlin, but it's great to have him back, and Mark Purton will take the drive. Can't tip against Merlin. I think Philippa, to be fair, $1.40 is very fair. Into $1.35. We'll try and get Mark Purton live on Trackside on Friday night. We'll be out there, get an update on obviously Self-Assured, Chase a Dream, and more importantly, Philippa, don't stop dreaming how he's come up after the Hunter Cup.
Thanks, Craig. Really looking forward to it. And don't forget as well, Friday night, we've got bonus back opportunities on the first two races from Addington and Alexandra Park. So if you don't end up finding that winner, but you finish second or third, you'll get a bonus bet up to $50 in your account, and the doggies as well at Hattrick. So all three meetings on Friday night will have bonus back opportunities on races 1 and 2. Thanks, Craig, for your time. Looking forward to having Craig on track at Alexandra Park and Mark Cookson on Friday, a meeting not to be missed. Feeling warm and bright,
it's such a by Love, the outside Love Poem, giving her plenty to think about, but she is pulling out plenty and she'll be unbeaten after three. Catch her by Love.
Charles Boy Panda, Go Gideon, Sweet Potential, she deserves this, she wins it well.
Couple home last week on the form. We'll start with the man that got one off first. Aidan Rodley, who's the one for you this week?
Yeah, I'm not going much braver than last week either. I'm going to the Herbie Dyke Stakes to wait for Adrian to a proven Group 1 star, and I think she'll be winning again. Favourites have a pretty good record in this race too, winning 5 of the last 9. But Legato looks to be very hard to beat in the wait for age. Bevan, who'd you go with?
Looking after your return on investment there, A-Rod. I'm going to Friday at Wanganui, and I think Alan Sherrick has a couple of really good chances in on the program, and the best of those for me is Lockanora in the last. We all saw this horse at Trentham, looking for black type into next season. I think this will probably be its last run of this preparation. Does have to step up to 75 grade, but I think she has the class to be continuing on her winning way.
And I'm going to go for a Greyhound on Friday, race number 10 out of Hattrick, big time bullet. Actually think Sweet Potential can win again on Sunday as well. But I like this dog here. He picked up a win on Tuesday, comes into a good draw on Friday night. Think he goes home a winner, and hopefully we'll get the opening odds for him at a nice price as well. Let's have a look at a summary. Who else is jumping in? Well, the Wales was Jeremiah at Alexandra Park. A big night there. Race number 8 in the program. Lochinora for Bevan. Big time bullet for myself. And Legato for Aiden at Te Rapa on Saturday in the Group 1 Herbie Dyke Stakes. That's all the time we've got. Thanks, guys, for your input. Looking forward to your coverage on Saturday. Until then, good luck on the punt, and we'll catch you back next week.